can be assigned. So this step of the property is satisfied in this selling one. Also consider the following today, this is one possibility, and that's a whole of course. Other possibility. This plan is consistent with this property, this part of the possibilities, as because they are satisfied by equivalent to the wind conditions, means that they are capable of upside and follows. Now we change the interpretation. For example, when
you, you know, arrange the edges. Okay? So you can use our method and obtain this particular solution, which is the optimal one, and it's also kind of famous, it's known as the Minkow Mask. Okay? So we know that topology synthesis is hard. Okay? If you consider a parametric chain and, you know, a standard reproducibility property, topology synthesis is NP-complete. If you compare it to a parameter synthesis, that can be widely studied, studies. So parameter synthesis is that topology is preserved and you're only changing probabilities of the transition. It's NP. So this slide, I'd like to demonstrate that the topology synthesis is quite hard. It's NP-complete with respect to the number of parameters. solutions from which you would like to choose. Okay. So, in this paper, we are presenting a method that is based on country-level-driven inductive SIGs, for short SIGs. So, SIGs have been introduced in 2005 by Solar Bazaman, also going to introduce a bit later, in non-probabilistic setting. And in this paper, we are discussing how SIGs can be adopted in stochastic systems. So, this is kind of a basic workflow. So, you have a family. You pick an instance, you call your favorite probability model checker, okay, in this case it's Storm, and it either accepts the realization in your memory, or it rejects and it provides a counter example. And now it's an important step. You don't want just to reject this particular instance. You would like to somehow utilize the counter example to prune more candidates, the candidate that have the same problem. Country example is valid for this case. So you can prove, let's say, this part of the subspace without calling the new verification first. And that's the key item. Okay? Here's just a small visualization of how you can use it for the synthesis problem where you would like to find all programs satisfying and all programs just valid.
Programs, set of subcommands with the same problem. We need to, for example,
yeah, this is really a simple example that demonstrates the fact that using, having this knowledge that this is come, for example, I can do something different. Okay, but you're right. In fact, it's just one edge. I know it's not really educated, but trust me, you generally need much more complicated structures to have it. Okay, so this gives you kind of the overall scheme how we can code CVs for probabilistic systems, and I will speak a few minutes about the slide. So again, we have this separation. We have a synthesizer and a verifier. The synthesizer, in our case, says 3, is basically represent the family of the programs as the first order formula for the whole assignment. Okay, so again, you have a program, you have a holes, for every holes you have a certain options. Okay? So basically the family, so all family is represented as the first order formula for the whole assignments. Okay? Then you ask the synthesizer, give me a model. Okay? A model is basically a whole a concrete whole assignment which yields a program. The program is then verified in our verifier, in our case, score model checker. Okay. We so now in this case, I assume that the properties are violated. So I am asking for a minimal high-level path, for example. So it's really the minimal subset of commands violating the property. And then I'm asking score to try to generalize the path, for example. So basically, I'm trying to get a set of programs that are also validated by this particular property. Okay? So again, I'm getting a set of whole assignments to be proved. Okay? Because I have a set of commands, set of programs that I know that are validated by the same property, so then I turn them to a set of assignments, and I'm basically these set of assignments are plugged in to my formula describing a family of programs that are still kind of interesting. Okay? And so basically you're iteratively prune the family of programs by adding these constraints, so basically these kinds of results. So again, this is a really similar setting than in the original paper. However, now we are really separating kind of this non-quantitative reasoning, where we know that SMP solvers are really efficient, and qualitative reasoning, where we know that SMP solvers are not efficient. So we actually try to do everything in one SMP kind of component, and it wouldn't work. And we know why. Because SMP, they don't know how to handle a multiplication, for example, or like probability. And you need to modify the probability to compute the probabilities. So, really, what is kind of the key message here? That we separated the qualitative reasoning here and the quantitative here, reasoning to be led to a standard modeling tools. Okay, so let me just briefly show you some experimental evaluation. So we implemented CVs on top of Python API and Score. We use caches in form of recently added files over the initial process. In our experimental setting or evaluation, we considered various synthesis problems like this threshold synthesis that you would like to identify all violating all satisfying. Optimal synthesis, various kinds of problems. However, we require a full exploration of the family. Because what is an alternative to these methods is a search-based approach. And you know, for example, a work by Randy Kalman, a few years back on ACA, showed that actually search-based techniques can be really useful to find satisfying solutions. But we would like to do more. We would like to actually But if you ask me for, let's say, 0.7, it's significantly about orders of magnitude simpler for us. And the reason is because you need less iteration, compute out the first orders, and then we have a kind of a quite extended discussion in the paper, but really, this one, important observation. The second, which is kind of obvious, the structure of the revenue also affects the performance. How the candidates are distributed, how their kind of level of satisfaction is distributed, I'm sure we'll get some numbers. Also, I didn't mention it explicitly, but we assume that we have more than one property to satisfy. Okay? And this is the benefit of Seek, is that it can use this multiple property specification to find good countries out. Good countries out are small countries out. Because a small country out mean that a smaller part of the program is involved, and therefore you can prune a large state, a large design. And also we figure out the size of underlying micro jets. It's not kind of so important because it doesn't affect the speed up. Perfect. So this is just here. I didn't want to show you some big tables. So I will just give you these three particular results or three particular examples. So what we are referring to, I'm showing here, is a speed up against baseline. So baseline is a naive exhaustive enumeration of all possible programs. Okay? So this dynamic program over management model, it has 9 holes, around 300,000 localization, in average every model has 5,000 states, and we were able to actually speed up between the 20 to 100. Again, this depth, okay, is given by by the properties we ask for, okay, and also by how we specify the holes, how the holes were here when you're actually moving the threshold of specification closer to the optimal, okay, you see how the number of iterations and the runtime is increasing. This is the reason why we see that the interval. Okay? So let me conclude. So I am presenting the method for synthesis of progressing programs. We use two kind of concepts, progress sketching. So the idea is that we don't want to synthesize just for specification. We also would like to have a certain domain knowledge given by users in the form of tempering or sketch and by a synthesis. We were surprised that there are a lot of applications where this synthesis can be applied, and not just in order to synthesize in DT and CD, but really a lot of problems for various domains can be translated to this problem. I presented Seeger, CD's approach. At TACAS, we presented a Seeger approach, this kind of orthogonal model. It's based on MDP-based extraction, and it has different performance characteristics. So, somewhere where CD's was poor, Seeger was better, and vice versa. So, again, this is not a silver bullet, but we can significantly shift the practical visibility of this problem, and this is future superb. Definitely, we need better sketch mining, because if we would like to offer this to engineers, we need a better sketch mining. So that's what we're trying to do now. And obviously, you know, fusion of CDS is here, hopefully in the next cap paper. And so obviously, and you know, combination of smart parameter synthesis, other models, and what is a big open question here, can we somehow handle infinite levels?
So I want to tell you about the design challenge of making a railway signaling system and how we built a specification and verification method for that, which is suited for a scope that is usually in engineering, that the scope is limited to one construction project. And I want to show you how we extended this verification tool into synthesizing and optimizing. So, when you came into this building this morning, maybe you noticed that there's a lot of railway tracks inside the building. And these railway tracks, I don't think they had any signaling system. But that gives us the same kind of viewpoint as the signaling engineers have. We can assume that they are given a track map, a map of the tracks and where they are and how long they are. And the signaling engineer's task is to use these tracks and consider how the trees will travel on those tracks. And the first component that they need to consider is detecting whether a train is on the track or not. So if we add a detector in the middle of the station here, we will now be able to detect whether the train is on this side or that side of the station, or whether both of the sides are occupied. And that's the input for the control system. And we also need some signals to give messages to the train drivers, which is the output from the control system. So maybe you are very impressed with the station that I built now. You should not believe because it's a very bad one. Actually, this is useless because now the trains are stuck there. So a lot of formal methods were just gone into showing that the control system can be safe, but is it actually a good design? There's also, in addition to a lot of formal methods work into railways, there's also operations research going into the construction of timetables, where you consider a large network of train stations and see how you can arrange trains on that network. However, both of these we call a timing optimization, but they don't usually deal with scalability. And there's also some heuristic algorithms that have been used in Germany to consider upgrading signaling systems. So these two views on how to use the railway is an important distinction here. We have the scalability view, where the length of the tracks and what you can, how you can arrange the trains onto the map is important. And there's the other view, which is to map the timeline of where trains are traveling onto one single path. So you get this diagram of what's it called, a blocking diagram, where you can see when the train is occupying different pieces of travel. So we started out wanting to verify that the station, that the railway project actually fulfills its desired performance properties. And we had to then devise a specification for what the capability of the system should be. So we have things like running time, frequency of trains, overtaking and crossing operations, which are examples that we got from railway engineers. And we made a structure for capacity specifications based on these examples. So we have a set of vehicle types, we have a set of movements, and each movement is then a train that has a certain sequence of visits. Visits can have alternatives, there's timing constraints. It's not a very complicated structure, maybe it looks a bit complicated on the slide, but let's go to the demo program. We start planning by saying we want to have a plan. Now there's one row here showing one train, and the train is now constrained to enter from the left side and to exit to the right side of the station. And now there's three possible dispatches that you can execute. These now correspond only to the three different paths that are possible to take. But we now want to add another train. Nothing much happens because now the train, the second train, also needs to have some visits. We tell it to visit the same nodes. So now there's lots of alternatives. You have the ordering of the trains and so on. But now let's add ordering constraints so that we get an overtaking operation. We say that the first train comes in first and it also leaves last. So that gives us only three possible dispatches. And each of them correspond to the specification that the second train has to leave first. So we see this also as a type of unit testing or regression testing that you can have in a railway construction project. If I now make some kind of a mistake here, I remove this detector, for example, I will immediately see that the specification is no longer satisfied. But if I remove enough, then it happens to be specified that now I'm happy with this change. So, performing this verification means that you have to perform a planning problem. And the planning problem is constrained by physical infrastructure, meaning that the train has to travel on the tracks. It's also constrained by the set of allocations that you can make to a train. You can only communicate to the driver that they should go from one signal and up until the next signal that they see. There's no way to tell them to stop in between. So this is something that you need to allocate as a unit. And also, of course, there's conflicting units of allocation that you can use. So you cannot have two routes, we call them routes. You cannot have two routes that use the same piece of track, obviously. There's also a limit to the communication between the control system and the driver. Usually, when you use optical signals, you're only capable of giving an authority, a movement authority to the train that proceeds two signals ahead. So actually, if you space signals too closely together, you will have to lower your velocity because you have not been given a long enough path. And finally, So we try to put all of this into one set of equations for the real numbers with the multiplication and everything, and solve it all at once with unknowns for when things happen. And we failed to do that because of the it took wrong in all the solvers we could find that were capable of doing these things. So we looked to the how the actual system works, and actually they split it the job into two parts. So the dispatcher has the overall global view of what happens, what kind of trains go where, and which what the sequence will be, while the train driver only has this limited view of how far are they around the tunnel, and they only plan ahead for when to start braking or accelerating. So we turn this into a verification program by splitting this into a discrete planning problem, where when you get a plan from the planning procedure, you simulate it on a discrete event simulator. So the main idea for the planner is to encode into a subproblem with which trains occupy which routes. And you do that in a series of steps, so you get planning as a bound and model checking. And when you have that state representation, you can add constraints to remove conflicting routes, make sure that the path has integrity, is consistent with the train actually moving there, and that this is happening in order to satisfy the specification. So, what we want to do is to use these verification techniques and build on them to synthesize signaling designs. So this verification system that we have works fast, as you can see in the interactive program. And in principle, we can use it then to explore the set of all possible signaling designs and decide whether they are good or not. So one problem is that we don't know how many components, how many signals and detectors we want. And there's also a real dimension to the location of each of them. So the first step that we take is to consider the planning problem without any signals or detectors. In that case, you will simply get an answer from the planner that it's not satisfied. There's not much more information to go on. However, we do have a feeling for where we could possibly add signals to improve scalability, to improve the chance that will succeed. So we just add all of these locations, and then we turn the synthesis problem into an optimization problem. So we start out with this initial design where we place signals and detectors around every branch so that we guard all the places where there's merging and branching going on. A second problem is that for verification, you can take each property separately and do the planning steps. However, when the signal locations are unknown, you would like to solve the problem for all properties at the same time. So we have to add instances of the subproblem for every property that we have. Now, once we have this matrix of planning steps and scenarios, we can add a Boolean to the problem saying whether a certain signal is used or not. So a solution to this problem now would be a plan for each of the properties. And in those plans, if it happens to be the case that every time you allocate a route that ends in a signal, you also allocate a route that starts from the same signal, that would mean that you could actually remove that signal. So we add a variable to indicate whether this is the case or not, and then we can solve the max sat problem to find the minimal amount of signals that we need. Actually, we use a sorting circuit so that we can still use the same incremental sat interface to solve max sat. So, with that, we now have a set of signals, So we have a black box goal function, and we have a continuous space. There's lots of numerical methods to choose from. We chose a simple one called Powell's method, which turns a multivariate real optimization problem into a line search, and then we use Rent's method for line search, which is well-behaved, which is fast when the function is well-behaved, and it's still robust when the function is not well-behaved. So, for example, if we would move a detector so far that there was no longer room for the train, then the score of that solution would suddenly jump to infinity, sorry, minus infinity, would suddenly be worthless. So in that case, we want also the method to be robust for these kinds of things. There's another trick to this numerical optimization is that we don't want actually the components to switch place, because we have a set of dispatch commands that we want to preserve. And also it makes the search space smaller, in a sense, if you, it makes the search space simpler, at least, if you don't allow this reordering of components. And to do that, we just take the leftmost signal and use the coordinates from 0 to 1, being the length of that track segment and so on. And then the second signal is now from 0 to 1 on the remaining part of the track. Alright, so the overall algorithm is then to take this track plan without signals to detectors, do the heuristic initial design, use sub-based planning to minimize the number of signals, and then we pass it over to the numerical optimization that moves the components continuously on the track that they're on. We call the simulator to evaluate which solutions are good or not. And finally, we can add new signals, even though we removed everything to be minimal. That was for scalability. We also want to try to add signals for timing. So in the tool, let's delete all objects. Now we don't have any plans. Sorry, we don't have any dispatches that can satisfy the plan. But if you ask the signal designer, then it will give us a design that we can put into the model here. That makes it again satisfied. Now note that both the detector on the left and the signal on the right are pushed to the very end of the track. So the signal should be as far ahead as it can, because that makes the train break at a later time, so it can hold a higher velocity as it is approaching the station. And also the detector on the left should be as far to the left as it can, because that makes the rest of the track free at an earlier time, so that the next train. Okay. That was the whole synthesis algorithm. However, synthesizing everything from scratch is not always appropriate. We might not have captured everything that the engineers care about. They might also have an existing design, and maybe they need a good reason to change that existing design. So just giving the railway engineers a program where with a button that says, here's your signaling system, is not going to work. So we have also considered how we can make use of each of these components to give smaller changes to the model, to the design. So the SAT component, the planning component, can suggest to the user that some components are redundant. Maybe they would still like to keep them. We can suggest also that signals should be moved. And we can also suggest adding new components. And the user can then investigate whether the cost of adding that component So we should note that this is not a complete method. The initial design is heuristic. It does not necessarily have the maximum capability. There could be, for example, if you want to have several trains sequentially into the same track, you have to add a heuristic for that. Also, the simultaneous planning might not, the minimal outcome from that might not be the starting point. We don't know that. And also, the cost function might have multiple problems. So we're working on this interactive tool to better collaborate with railway engineers and see which of these things are valuable and which need improvement. One thing that we can see is that this specification language where we have each train movement that is going to happen simultaneously with another train movement is explicitly specified. For large terminals, this will not be a way that you want to work. Also, we should note that this assumes a fixed block design principle, meaning that we have this principle where